Disciple Up number 281, Stewardship Part 5, Children, Ministry, and My Weaknesses. This is Disciple Up, the Disciple Empowering Podcast, where psychology, science, the real world, sin, self, and culture meet head on, and Scripture rules. If you're a follower of Christ looking to grow or looking for some biblical answers, then get ready, because it's time to disciple up. Hey, everybody. Welcome to Disciple Up. My name's Louie. I'm your host for this podcast. Thanks for tuning in, for downloading, tuning in, coming from my old radio days, which were extremely unimpressive. So if you didn't know I was on the radio, neither does anybody else. Okay, anyway, yeah, 10 years, roughly, I volunteered at a Christian station here in Parker, Arizona. So there you go. We are continuing our study of discipleship. Well, it is sort of part of discipleship. It's called stewardship, though. Hello. And we're going to take a look at some things today that I think one of them might surprise you. And then I've got another one coming up next week, I think, because it's like a really big one that I think will also surprise you in terms of viewing these things as part of your stewardship to God. So before we jump in, I'm still looking for people to contact me. I'm always looking for people to contact me. And they never do, so I'm beginning to think that I'm just talking to myself out here. But anyway, if you have anything you'd like to say, questions you'd like to ask, suggestions on future topics for the podcast or anything else, you can get a hold of me two simple ways. One is to send me an email, Louie, L-O-U-I-E, at discipleup.org. And the other is to go to our Facebook page, assuming that you have Facebook, facebook.com/discipleup, and leave any questions and or comments there. All right. So let's jump in. We've been looking at biblical stewardship. We sort of summed up a lot of it in the three words: leadership, servanthood, and trust, or faithfulness, or being faithful. And then last week we took a look at the week before last. Let's put it that way. We looked at some of the larger concepts, some false concepts. And then last week, of course, we spent the whole podcast on marriage. If you have not heard that and you're married or thinking of getting married, yeah, go listen to it. Because there's some stuff in Ephesians 5 that you may not have noticed before. And so I think you should definitely give a listen to that podcast. Kind of makes me sad that so few have heard it, because I know how many downloads I've had of it. It's not that what I'm saying here is new. I'm actually saying things that a lot of other people are saying, but it's just not as widely known as it should be. And I think it would help a lot of marriages if people understood this. So whether you hear it from me or somebody else is not important. That you hear it is important. So that's all I'm going to say about that. Go check out episode 280 if you have not listened to it. All right. The next part of our stewardship, and this is something I'm not going to spend much time on. If you did hear last week, you may be thinking you spent a lot of time on everything. But no, not really, and not on this. And that is children. Now, if you have children, he said, I had to take a break to answer a very important phone call there. Or grandchildren. This also would apply, I think, to grandchildren to lesser extent. But if you have children, then obviously they're a gift from God. And therefore, what you do with them, how you treat them, how you raise them, the things you teach them, everything, that's all part of your stewardship to God. So, and obviously this is amazingly critically important. And it is interesting to me, too, that in the Bible, given the importance of child rearing, there's not maybe as much in there as you might expect there to be. And I think that's because, and again, I have no children. So obviously I have no grandchildren, just in case you're wondering, each child is different and parents are different and families are different and places are different and all that's different. So while many of the principles remain the same, application can be very different depending on the child that you're dealing with. And Paul says this in Ephesians chapter 6, verse 4, after he's just finished the big thing that we talked about last week with marriage and loving the husbands, loving their wives as Christ loves the church, which to me is the greatest advertisement for celibacy ever written by the hand of man, inspired by the Holy Spirit. But anyway, he says this in Ephesians 6, 4, fathers, do not provoke your children to anger, but bring them up in the discipline and instruction of the Lord. He doesn't give any advice to mothers, just fathers. So, those of you that are prowling around looking for sexism in the Bible, aha! Why doesn't he mention mothers? Well, who knows? You know, you cannot draw conclusions from silences. And if you do draw conclusions from silences, you better be very careful and tentative about it. But he does here say something that I have found to be a problem with not all, but most fathers. And that is, they tend more than most mothers, and again, this is most, they tend to provoke their children to anger more than mothers do. Now, I've known some moms that have done that, believe me. My mom wasn't one of them most of the time, but my dad certainly could make me angry. Oh, boy, when I was little. So, yeah, because the fathers tend to be, in most cultures, the big stick, right? Wait till your father comes home kind of a thing. The mothers tend to be more loving and nurturing. And so in that context, it's easy to be a little overly strict or a little too much. And Paul says, don't do that. Part of your stewardship to God is to make sure that your children are raised in the discipline and instruction of the Lord. Okay, not in the discipline and instruction of you know, not the way you were raised, not the way your parents or grandparents raised you or told you that you should be raised, not in the way that maybe say you're a veteran, that you went into the military and it changed your life and all that. But no, it's in the discipline and instruction of the Lord. And so everything that I do or don't do with my children in terms of setting up how I'm going to raise them and what we're going to do and principles, et cetera, all that has to be derived from God and His word and His nature and His love and His grace and His truth, not simply what I learned or what I like or the way that my personality tends to want to express itself. That is not the discipline and instruction of the Lord. That is the discipline and instruction of you or me or somebody else or us, if it's a cultural thing. So we have to focus on how do we raise our children in a way that's going to make God real to them. That, yes, of course, it involves discipline. All child rearing involves discipline of one sort or another and instruction. So again, servant love, when I love my children as a servant, it helps them to grow into Christ. Now, when I say servant love for your children, I do not mean that children rule the roost. That's a disaster. The idea of servant leadership is not that the leader has no authority. Otherwise, because if it was, then he wouldn't be called a leader. Of course, leaders have authority. Otherwise, you're not leading, right? But servant leadership is someone, a servant leader, someone who uses their authority and their power to help other people and to lift them up, not to put them down, not to stand on top of them and achieve my goal as your leader. Now, that's not real, authentic leadership, and it's certainly not servant leadership. It's not biblical at all. So, parents are servant leaders to their children, and they love them and they serve their children by telling them what to do, by disciplining them, by doing all that stuff, but also by helping them and by allowing them, especially as the child gets older, to maybe do things that, you know, you don't really see much point in, but, you know, the child is really drawn to that. Maybe you don't care about music, but you've got a child who is musical. Well, then if you're going to love your child as a servant, you're not going to make them go out and play sports. If they're really driven and they really love and they're passionate about music, then let them give it a shot. That's servant love. That's just one silly little example, but I'm sure you get the point. That's what God is calling upon us to do. And as parents, that's why parenting is so hard, because, again, it involves serving and doing what's best for the other person, and that's never easy. And that's all. I could say more about children, but I'm always reluctant to do that because I'm not a parent. And so there's plenty of other people out there who are parents that teach on this, and you can, you know, check them out. Or if you really want to know more from my perspective, I have no idea why you would. But if you do, you can contact me. Email me, Louie, L-O-U-I-E, at discipleup.org. Drop by the Facebook page. Leave a question, a comment, a thought, an insult. I don't care. I'll respond. So there you go. So you've got, obviously, as we covered last week, marriage is a huge part of your stewardship if you are married. Raising children is the same. Many of the principles are the same. I talked last week about there's no room for your ego in your marriage, and there's no room for your ego in raising your children either. When you see these parents at sporting games that are just all over the place and out of control, and sometimes they have to actually ban them from the games because they're so bad, there's somebody whose ego is, they're trying to live out their dreams of sports greatness or whatever through their child. And it's not just sports either. In music and drama and anything, you can get into that where you're trying to live your life through your child vicariously. That's a mistake. You let your child live their life. You just are there to help grow them up in the discipline and instruction of the Lord. Next thing that we need to think about in terms of stewardship. This one's fairly obvious, but it has to be discussed. And that is ministry. My ministry, or my ministries, plural, have to be looked at as part of my stewardship to God. In the book of 2 Timothy, chapter 1, verses 6 through 9, Paul talks about this to Timothy. He says, "For this reason, I remind you to fan into flame the gift of God which is in you through the laying on of my hands. For God gave us a spirit, not of fear, but of power and love and self-control. Therefore, do not be ashamed of the testimony about our Lord, nor of me, his prisoner, but share in the suffering for the gospel by the power of God, who saved us and called us to a holy calling, not because of our works, but because of his own purpose and grace, which he gave us in Christ Jesus before the ages began." Whew. Okay, there's like a ton of stuff here. Oh, man. It is just so amazing what Paul says here. It's just, wow, it's just so deep. We're probably not going to get all of them, but we'll get some of them. So let's take a look at this then. First thing he does is he wants to remind Timothy to fan a gift, whatever it is. Of course, we don't know what the gift is, but he wants him to fan it into flames. This is stewardship. Stewardship is realizing I have gifts and talents. Some of them I may not be that aware of. Some of them I may have a hard time believing that I actually have this ability. And some of them I may know I have, but I don't want. Nevertheless, if God gave me the gift, then I need to fan that into flame and make it available for him to use through me should he choose to do that. Now, in Timothy's case, he says, which the gift, which is in you through the laying on of my hands. So it's very interesting. So Paul, at some point, probably shortly before he left, you would imagine, but perhaps at a different time, laid hands on Timothy, prayed for him, and saw some sort of evidence that God gave Timothy a particular gift. And again, we have no idea what the gift could be. So there's no point in speculating about it. It's a total waste of time. I don't know. You don't know. No one knows. If someone tells you they do know, they don't know. And if they tell you that they do know, that's a good reason not to listen to them when they try to interpret the Bible, because they're clearly incompetent and delusional at the best. So Paul says, you got to fan this into flame. So right there, God gives us the gift, but we are responsible for what we do with our gifts. That's stewardship right there in a nutshell. Bam. God looks at me and says, what are you doing with what I gave you, Louie? And in the end, when I stand before him, he will ask me these questions. Now, my salvation doesn't depend on it, like Paul says, but my rewards in heaven do. So I got to fan these things into flame. Then Paul says, God gave us a spirit, not of fear. Now, the fact that he says this, probably, I mean, I don't think it's an unreasonable conclusion to draw that Timothy may have been, almost certainly was, struggling with some fear. Yeah, I remember Timothy's a younger man in a leadership position trying to lead people older than him. That's hard. I know. I did it when I first went into ministry. Well, I tried to do it. I didn't do a very good job. It's very hard. It's very hard for younger people to do that. And it's even harder for older people to let them do it. Now that I'm an old guy, I can tell you that a lot of times when younger people try and do that, it's hard for me because you just look at this young man and or woman, as the case may be, doesn't matter, this young person, and you just think, what do they know that they should be telling me? But, you know, if they're in the leadership position, they're in the leadership position, and I have to let them lead. Not easy. So Paul says, not of fear, but of power. It's the word dunamis in Greek, of love, agape, and self-control. Now, it's that last one that's really interesting in all kinds of different ways. But it speaks to what God is all about. And God does not ever push you to lose control of yourself and just freak out. Now, a lot of people will say that he does. A few years, well, it's more than a few years ago now, it's probably, I don't know, 15, 20 years ago, there was this holy laughter stuff that was going on. It came out of Ontario, Canada. It was kind of like a thing for a while, a big thing in some churches. And that's what that was about. It was about losing control and laughing hysterically and whatever, and that was the Holy Spirit doing that, supposedly. Well, of course, a lot of people looked askance at this because there's no actual example of the Holy Spirit ever doing that in the Bible. And then there's the whole lack of self-control thing. It is not a mark of the Spirit of God being on you in power that you lose control. Rather, the opposite is true, because this verse says God gave us a spirit of power and love and self-control. So if you're out of control, is that the Holy Spirit? Or is that you? Is that your emotions, your ego running wild? Well, I think it's the latter, and I think that's bad stewardship, and the Bible agrees with me. So understand this. When the Holy Spirit comes upon you in power and love, he also gives you the ability to channel that love and control that power in such a way that it does good, not bad, that it highlights Jesus, not you or me, and that it ends in glory to God, not glory to us. So Now, a lot of times we don't think about the Holy Spirit that way because we think about the Holy Spirit in all kinds of weird ways. That's why I wrote a book on the Holy Spirit, Every Day in the Spirit, which you can pick up at Amazon.com. Just put Louie Marsh and Every Day in the Spirit in, and the book will pop up. It's available in print or as an ebook for your Kindle, whichever you choose. And it's as cheap as they will let me sell it to you. All right. Then he goes on, therefore, now this is, he's saying, because the things I just told you are true, Timothy, the following things are also true. So based on what I just said, God gave you this gift. He's not given you a spirit of fear, but of power and love and self-control. You should not be ashamed of the testimony about our Lord, nor of me as prisoner. Obviously, because shame has fear in it, right? And if I have a spirit that's not a spirit of fear, but of power, love, and self-control, then I have no shame. So I'm not ashamed because I'm not afraid. But, he goes on, share in suffering for the gospel by the power of God. Now, this is a complex statement here. Good stewardship is sharing in the suffering of the gospel, not as a helpless, weak victim, which is how it looks, I grant you, but by the power of God. So when the Spirit of God comes upon us, the Spirit of power, love, and self-control, He empowers us then to share in the suffering for the gospel through and by His power. The power of God leads to suffering. Now, most of us look at it the opposite way. I'm suffering for that, and God's going to give me the power to overcome it. Give me the power, Lord. Give me the power. Yes, Lord, the power. Yeah. But that's not how Paul talks about it. And that's not how Paul lived it out, if you know anything about the life of Paul, which we will get into probably next week, because I've got something that popped into my mind a few weeks ago when I was teaching on stewardship, something I did not cover in Africa, didn't even think about. But wow, it's powerful, and I hadn't thought of it before. Maybe you have, but I hadn't. So Paul says, Timothy, good stewardship here. This is an example of stewardship, remember, is suffering for the gospel, not out of weakness, but out of the power of God, which appears as weakness to the world, I'll grant you. Because they're looking at, you know, how many people have you got? How many guns have you got? How much money have you got? How much blah, blah, blah. Christians show up with none of that, but they have the Holy Spirit in them, which gives us the self-control to stay and serve God, not run away. And if we have to suffer, then we suffer. That's powerful. The gospel, suffering for the gospel, by the power of God, verse 9, who saved us and called us to a holy calling. Actually, I hadn't even noticed that one, but let's talk about that for just a second. What does that mean? Holiness is one of those things we don't talk about much anymore. And part of the reason why, as is in all things, is because we are in a constant... We're in a constant swinging of the pendulum. When you look at what's being taught in churches today, what's being featured, what we talk all about, one of the reasons that they stress whatever it is they're stressing, like let's talk about the love of God, because that's all we ever talk about in the church today, it seems to me. And almost all of our songs are about the love of God, particularly the new worship choruses and stuff. Why are we talking so much about that? Because the way we perceive the church in America in the past, and I don't mean 100 years ago or 200 years ago, I mean 40 or 50 years ago, was that they didn't talk enough about the love and the grace of God. And so with that pendulum, it swung the other way. I would argue it swung too far, because if you're not talking about discipline, and you're not talking about suffering, and you're not talking about holiness, you're not representing the Bible very well, because it talks about all those and a whole lot more. And here Paul says this, that God saved us and called us to a holy calling. So we're called to live a holy life. not to run around and pick and choose the commands that we want to follow and obey. And so I was just reading something today. It's interesting. The guy was talking about a guy that was all up and down all over him because this pastor wasn't politically active enough, you know, in the causes that this man felt were important. And actually, I would actually agree with this man that these things are important, but would disagree that it should be done through the church. But anyway, they were talking about this. And so the pastor didn't actually know this guy. He was brand new to the church, and he got to know him and found out that, this guy was living with his girlfriend outside of marriage. You see, he missed the holy calling part, didn't he? Oh, he wanted to go fight the battles in the culture war, fight the, you know, this and fight that and do this, and we've got to stop that from happening. But he wasn't willing to apply those same biblical standards to himself. See, it's easy to miss the holy calling. It's easy to say, well, you know, we're going to support this guy and follow this guy or woman, this person, even though we know that they're wrong here and that they're bad there and they're not doing the right thing over here, but they're saying good things about these things, and that's really important, so we're going to support them in that. Is that really what God wants us to do? Really? You know, we've got an election in 2 weeks. Think and pray about that. And then, you know, however you vote, you vote. I don't know how you're going to vote. I honestly don't care. Or if you vote. In fact, and if you don't know what's going on, if you haven't studied the issues, please do us all a big favor and don't vote, because that's bad stewardship. If you're going to vote, you need to invest enough time to know what you're talking about and then draw the conclusions you're going to draw from scripture and prayer and studying the candidates and go from there. God's called us to a holy calling. Why? Why? Not because of our works. Now, there you go. Now we're sounding very Pauline, right? Because he's going to talk about grace. But that's not all that he talks about. But because of his own purpose and grace, which he gave us in Christ Jesus before the ages began. Okay, so we've got more amazingness just here. I keep, every time I think that I'm done with this passage, I find more stuff. All right. His own purpose and grace. Well, we know about the grace of God. We talk about the grace of God all the time. And purpose, well, you know, the Purpose-Driven Life's the best-selling book ever, I think, at this point. Not, you know, excluding the Bible, but, you know. And I've read the book several times, and I've been through the Purpose-Driven Life spiritual growth campaigns twice. And I don't agree with everything, you know, that Rick Warren ever says or does, but I think that's a really good book, and I think people ought to read it. But understand this, you're not the only one with a purpose. Your purpose comes from God's purpose for you because of his own purpose and grace, which he gave us in Christ. So when you become a Christian, you receive the grace of God, which saves you, and the purpose of God, which is what? Well, that's why he gives you the gifts and talents that he's given you so that you can fulfill his purpose for your life. And you do that not by cowering in fear, but by allowing the Holy Spirit to fill your heart and to give you his power and love and self-control. And he did all this not when you accept Christ. He did all this before the ages began, Paul says. He gave us in Christ Jesus before the ages began. In other words, before God created anything, he had his plan laid out completely, knew exactly what was going to happen and exactly what he was going to do. And these things are ours because he has a purpose for our lives. And his purpose works through his grace, not through our great and mighty deeds, because our deeds are seldom great nor mighty from a spiritual perspective. So there you go. Three verses out of 1 Timothy. Amazing. And I could talk more about them because they're so amazing. It's just, wow. That's my ministry. You see, that's stewardship. It's fanning these things into flame. It's getting busy doing the work of God, fulfilling his holy calling, which was ours in his mind before creation was created. Think about that. Not just before you were created, or I was created a few years ago by historical standards, but before the universe was made, God had all this set out. Now, when it comes to ministry, you have to then think about your gifts and your talents, of course, like Paul says, fan it into flame. And I remember many years ago, back in the 90s, late 90s, yeah, I heard a guy on the radio, and he was kind of funny, and he was interesting, and he had said some things that I hadn't thought of before, so it was challenging my thinking and all that. And he had a phrase that he used over and over again, and the phrase was, talent on loan from God. Now, if you're, you know, you probably know now who that fellow was. That was the late Rush Limbaugh. Now, you may or may not like his politics. You may or may not have enjoyed his show and his presentations that he did and all that stuff. But I will submit to you, you can't argue with that statement. Talent on loan from God. He talked about himself that way, of course. And he was right. His talent was on loan from God, but so's everyone else's. So there's nothing that makes him special here. No, he's simply, like all the rest of us, a recipient of these gifts from God, of his natural talents, whatever those might be, your natural talents, whatever they are. And then when you become a Christian, you receive spiritual gifts. And I want to share some verses on gifts with you in terms of, yes, of course, stewardship. Paul says in 1 Corinthians 12, 4 through 7, now there are varieties of gifts, but the same Spirit. There are varieties of service. And I want you to think about these words that he's using here, because they do have meaning. There are varieties of service, but the same Lord. There are varieties of activities. This is the ESV translation. But it is the same God who empowers them in all, who empowers, okay, I can't even read today, I'm sorry. But it is the same God who empowers them all in everyone. To each one is given a manifestation of the Spirit for the common good. Okay, now he uses these gifts here. I want you to think about gifts, service, activities. We know what a gift is. This is an ability that God gives us, okay? So there are varieties of gifts. There's one Holy Spirit, but he gives out all kinds of different gifts and abilities to people. And you got some of them, whether you like it or not, or want to admit it or not. And if you are hiding your gifts and your talents under a, you know, like hiding your light under a bushel, well, then you're being a bad steward. That's horribly bad stewardship. But there's also varieties of service, because you can have two people with the same gift or the same gift set. That is, you might have the gift of leadership and evangelism. And how that appears, though, is different. There are varieties of service, but the same Lord. There are varieties of activities, but the same God who empowers them all. That's also an important phrase. So basically, here's what Paul is saying. We each get gifts. We also get levels of gifts at which these gifts are used, and a different kinds of power that make the gift work. Let's take the gift of evangelism, for example. I know people who have the gift of evangelism who could never stand up in front of people and deliver an evangelistic sermon. I mean, they could try, but it probably wouldn't be very good. And they would hate it, and probably most of the people listening would hate it as well. But what they love to do and what they are great at doing is sitting down and talking to people one-on-one, or, you know, two or three people at a time, just in a, you know, just in a nice private little conversations, sharing the gospel, leading people to Christ. That's how their gift works. That's their variety of service. That's the power that flows through them. It works best with individuals. Other people might be in small groups or in small classes. Other people might be like the, and there's still a few of these guys around, not many, I grant you, but the traveling evangelists who show up, put up a tent or rent a building or use a church, and there might be a couple of hundred people there. And then you've got people like the late, great Billy Graham, who spoke to thousands, and even late in his life, probably to a million people at once. See, that's the same gift, evangelism, but it's almost unrecognizable because the level that it's used at and the power that flows through it is different. And we're all different. And Billy Graham is not a better evangelist than the guy who sits down at the coffee shop with his friend and shares the gospel and leads him to Christ. He's a different kind of evangelist. He's not better. And that's our problem as Americans, of course. It's all about the numbers, right? So we would look at someone like that and we would think, wow, Billy's such a better evangelist. Well, maybe, but not simply based on the numbers, because this man or woman is gifted by God and called by God and equipped by God to bless other people in small, intimate conversations. And most of those people probably would never go to a Billy Graham crusade or could be reached that way, but they can be reached talking one-on-one. You see, it's different ways to reach different people, but it's the same God, the same Spirit giving out these gifts. And as he says in verse 7, such an important verse, to each is given the manifestation of the Spirit for the common good. In other words, you are not given gifts to look cool and to set yourself apart from other Christians and to lord it over them and to have people go, wow, he's so gifted. Wow, look at that. Oh, she's amazing. Nope, that's not the point. Your gifts are given you to serve other people as good stewards. To be a good steward of your gifts is to use them to bless other people, not to bloat your own reputation. In the book of 2 Timothy, chapter 1, he goes on. We just talked about Timothy a minute ago, but we just finished verse 9 in 2 Timothy 1. Well, now down in verse 11, he kind of picks it back up. He says this, for which I was appointed as a preacher and apostle and teacher, which is why I suffer as I do, but I am not ashamed. Notice that. For I know whom I have believed, and I am convinced that he's able to guard until that day that which he has entrusted to me, ESV is slightly different than the version I used to reading this in. I am convinced that he is able to guard until that day what has been entrusted to me. And then he says to Timothy, follow the pattern of sound words that you've heard from me in the faith and love that are in Christ Jesus by the Holy Spirit who dwells within us. Guard the good deposit entrusted to you. Oh, interesting. So stewardship is using my gifts to bless other people and help them, but it's also a deposit that I have to guard. How do I guard it? Well, I got to use it. If it just sits there and does nothing, then it rots away or rusts away. But Paul says, I'm convinced that he, God, is able to guard until that day what's been entrusted to me. And then he says to Timothy, by the Holy Spirit, guard the good deposit entrusted to you. So he's telling Timothy to do the same thing that he is doing, and that is take care, guard, watch over, protect, preserve what God has deposited in you. And what is that? Well, according to what he said up there in verse 6 of 2 Timothy 1, fan into flame the gift of God which is in you. That's the deposit that he's talking about, that precious gift which is given, why? To bless and help other people, not to bless and help us ourselves. Yeah. So stewardship is all about my ministry and how I carry my ministry out and what I do with the gifts and the talents and the blessings that I have from God. One last verse on this, and then we'll move on to my last point today. 1 Peter 4:10, as each has received a gift, notice that, we all have got one, whether you like it or not, you have it. Sorry. Use it to what? Serve one another for the common good. Same thing as Paul said. As good stewards of God's varied grace. So Peter, very helpfully, comes right out and says it. Hey, if you're not making good use of what God's gifted you, you're not being a good steward. If you want to be a good steward of what God's given you, you've got to use it in the way it was intended to be used to fulfill the purposes that God gave it for you. Wow. Yeah. Wow. So how I use my gifts, my very use of them, number one. Secondly, how I use them, when and where I use them, and the way that I try to improve and hone my gifts and prepare them and improve them and grow in them. Look, just because God gives you the ability to speak doesn't mean you don't need to take classes on it and to study how to be a good speaker and to listen to other people who are good speakers and learn from them. Of course you do. That's good stewardship. If you think you've got it all because God gave you the gift of preaching and you're the God's gift to the world in terms of preaching, you are almost assuredly wrong. And even if you are the best in the world, you still have things to learn, and God would like to teach you if you could stop trying to be God and just realize He's God, you're not. You're here to serve others and to use that gift for the common good as a good steward of God's varied grace. So that's it. My ministry is me attempting to be a good steward of God's varied grace that He's given me in my life. Now, one last thing that I want to talk about, and that is, if I'm going to be a good steward, last thing for this, for today, not, we're still going on with this, I must be a good steward of my weaknesses. Oh, I remember when this first occurred to me when I was studying. I actually got up, walked back to my associate pastor's office and said, hey, Bree, have you ever thought about this? And we discussed it for a little while because it had never occurred to me until that moment when I was studying, preparing to go to Malawi to teach this. I am called by God to be a good steward of my weaknesses. God deliberately gave me my weaknesses. He knows what they are, and He wants to use them for His glory. Therefore, I must steward them as well as my strengths. See, we focus on strength, right? It's all about the strengths. Use your strengths for God, and that's all great. But, you know, God used a lot of weak people in the Bible and often used them in the areas of their weaknesses, like, say, Moses as an example. And Paul, it would be another example. And we want to take a look at this today, just kind of quickly. And then next week, we're going to talk about the one that didn't even occur to me until last week. And I'll save that for next week. Yes, I'm teasing you. I'm trying to get you to come back. Maybe tell some friends that you need to listen to this and bring them back with you. Here's what Paul says about his weaknesses. Now, again, this is a very famous passage of Scripture, which we love to read and pretty much ignore most of the time. And that is 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verses 8 through 10. Three times I pleaded with the Lord about this. This is thorn in the flesh. He wanted God to heal him. He wanted God to take it away. Three times I pleaded with the Lord about this, that it should leave me. But He said to me, my grace is sufficient for you. That's the first thing that really grabs your attention, right? And it should. For my power is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, again, we'll talk about that word in a minute, I will boast the more, all the more gladly, sorry, about my weaknesses, of my weaknesses, so that the power of Christ may rest upon me. And then he says, for the sake of Christ, then, I am content with weaknesses, insults, hardships, persecutions, and calamities, for, y'all know this one, I'm sure, when I am weak, then I am strong. Yes, we know this verse. We like to quote this verse to comfort people who are struggling with their weaknesses, but I don't think we live this verse out. And in fact, I've heard many preachers, you know, kind of, sort of, you know, focus so much on using your strengths that they forget about your weaknesses and even shame people for, you know, talking about them. Now, I have a lot of weaknesses, and we could be here, believe me, all day for many days, days upon end, weeks, months, maybe eons even, talking about them. But one in particular, and I use this as an example in Malawi, is I have always had a very hard time remembering people's names. Now, when you tell people that, of course, at my age now when I say it, oh, you're getting old, blah, 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 but I've always had this problem. In my 20s, when I entered the ministry, I had this problem. Back then, people say, well, if you really were listening, if you paid attention, if you really cared about people, you'd remember their names. But that's not true, because I met some people I desperately wanted to remember their names, and I forgot them. In particular, I'm thinking of a very, and this happened to me more than once, but I remember in particular one time, this really attractive young woman. Oh, wow. I just was like, you know, whoa. And I was introduced to her, and then things happened. And then, you know, a little bit later in the gathering, I was coming back around, and there she was, and I wanted to go talk to her. But I couldn't remember her name. And believe me, I wanted to so bad. So now how are you going to go talk to someone whose name you don't remember? Well, that makes it a little more difficult. And if you go up and say, hey, I think you're beautiful and amazing. What's your name again? Yeah. You want to really not go over well with someone, try that. So maybe that's why I'm still single. Who knows? But anyway, so it's not just because I don't care or because I'm not trying. It's just for some weird reason the way my mind works. I mean, all of our brains are wired a little differently. For example, I'm terrible at rote memory, another weakness, unless you put it to music and then I can remember it. The only reason I passed math in grade school was because they taught us our multiplication tables to music, and I picked them up just like that. They used to have these little scratchy, tiny little record players. They put a 45 on it, and it's easy as pie to multiply, reciting your tables to music. And then they'd go through, 2 times 2 is 4. Ba, 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 ba. That's how I learned. That's the only way I passed that class. That hadn't been put to music, who knows. So that's how my mind works. Okay, that's a weakness I have. And I've been embarrassed and kind of ashamed about that and tried to hide it and work around it my whole life. And I remember probably 15 years ago now, I was driving to San Diego to see somebody, and my MP3 player, because that's what we had back then before smartphones, died. The battery died, so I was listening, flipping around some radio station, and I don't know why, but I stopped on this Christian station, and this guy was talking, and he was talking about this verse, and he talked about how he mentioned one of his weaknesses and how he wasn't going to try and hide it anymore, that he was going to really boast about it, as Paul said. And it hit me. I've taught this passage who knows how many times, but I haven't been living it out because I've been ashamed. I've been hiding. I got to stop that. What about you? Are you being a good steward and admitting that you have these weaknesses and asking God to use them? Because that's what good stewardship of weaknesses comes down to. It's asking God and letting God use your weaknesses. Is that you or not? All right, let's go through this passage slowly and kind of break it out. 3 times I pleaded with the Lord about this, that it should leave me, but he said to me, okay, now we're getting into it, my grace is sufficient for you. Let's just stop right there. Very hard to argue with that statement, isn't it? The grace of God, which saves us, but that's not all it does. See, a lot of people, they're kind of in the mindset, and I've had many interesting conversations with people about this, is that they will say that, you know, the grace of God saves us, but then we're kind of on our own, right? No, you're not. That is incorrect. The grace of God works in our lives as Christians beyond saving us. Our whole life is based on the grace of God. And so we must cling to that and we must understand it. So when he says, my grace is sufficient for you, that applies to suffering. That when I'm suffering, whether it's physical suffering or mental suffering or emotional suffering, or you're suffering in a bad relationship, marriage, whatever, your relationship with your kids or your parents or whatever it is, God's grace can be sufficient for you if you will let him do that. My grace is sufficient for you, for my power. Notice he doesn't say all power, not our power, but his power, my power, God says to Paul. He's quoting, this is what God said to him. My power is made perfect in weakness, close quote. So God said, my grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. Bam. That's all that God said. That's what the Lord said to him. Now, the word perfect does not mean without flaw. That's how we interpret the word perfect. The Greek word, and the way the Greeks and the Hebrews and everybody else thought about it back in the day, was the word means to complete, to bring something to completion or to maturity. So a horse that ran very fast would have been called telos, perfect. The Greek word's telos. If you had an extremely sharp knife that just cut so well, that was the perfect knife. Why? Because a knife is designed to cut and a horse is designed to run, and etc. So when God says my power is made perfect in weakness, he's saying this is where my power really matures in you. Why? Well, obviously, if I'm in a weak area and I'm having to serve God in this weak area, who else am I going to rely on? I'm not relying on me. Because I don't have any power or very little power or ability in that area. So I have to rely on God. And it's in those tough times. It's in those times of great stress and weakness that I do learn to rely on God. And that's how that works. So Paul then draws a conclusion. Therefore, and when you see the word therefore, you should always ask, what's it there for? Because of what God just said to me, the following things are true. Paul is going to give us his conclusions from what God has said. I will boast. I will boast. All the more gladly. This is how Paul is applying what God said to him. His application of my powers made perfect in weakness is, I will boast all the more gladly of my weaknesses so that the power of Christ might rest upon me. Ooh, think about that for a minute. He's saying that when you boast about this, that is, when you really trust God in these areas, God's power comes down and rests on you. And so you can be very, very weak in certain areas, and as you are, as I am, as all are, but there can be strength there. It's not my strength. It's God's strength, but it's strength. And that's what I want. So verse 10, for the sake of Christ, then, I am content with weaknesses, insults, hardships, persecutions, and calamities. Okay, hold on now. I am content with weakness. So are you content with your weakness? Or does it bother you? Are you trying to overcome it? Are you trying to do better with it? Are you trying to hide it? Are you content with it? Maybe if it's something where you know you have no control over it. Now, there are some weaknesses that you can improve on. Obviously, physical weaknesses. You know, you can do exercise and whatever. But if you break your back and you are a paraplegic, for example, well, there you go. You have to learn to be content with that because you can't change it. And it's when I learn to be content with my weaknesses that the power of Christ rests on me, and then he can do whatever he chooses to do. So Paul says, I'm content with weaknesses. with insults. Well, people insult you about your weaknesses. Happens a lot. And I will be content with that. Hardships that come about as a result of my weaknesses, I will accept that. Persecutions that come to me because I'm a Christian. And calamities, when bad things happen, stuff just out of control, just out of nowhere, boom, stuff, bad stuff happens. What's my attitude? My attitude should be, God, you're in control. I'm trusting you. It's going to be okay. 4, he concludes, when I am weak, then I am strong. Now, that is obviously a logical contradiction, right? How can you be strong but weak at the same time? Well, this is how, because it's not my strength, it's God's strength. It's my weakness, but it's not my strength. So I can be weak because that's the way I am, but I can also have strength there because that's how God is. And when his power rests on me, then I am strong. It is a contradiction, but it is a profound truth. And it can change how you live your life if, like Paul, we can learn to boast about my weaknesses. Now, the problem with that is, if you do that today, in today's culture, what happens? You will get the self-esteem lecture. You need to love yourself. You need to be, you should not criticize yourself. Me, 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 me. Ugh. Yeah, there's no escape for that. I put that under insults, hardships, and persecutions because I've heard it so often. It didn't help that even in grade school, my sense of humor was self-deprecating, so I got those kind of lectures in grade school. Even way back when I was a kid, the term self-esteem and self-love was not ever used. Self-esteem, I don't even think existed as a term, but they would... Now, I remember some of my teachers telling me I shouldn't, you know, be so critical of myself and blah, blah. They didn't get... I was joking. It was a joke, but they didn't get it. So, okay. So you're just going to have to live with our culture's manic obsession with everything being positive when anyone with half a brain knows everything is not positive. And I'm not going to lie about it. And I'm not going to pretend not to have weaknesses to make you happy or to make this stupid culture I live in happy. The heck with all that. Let's boast it. Let's tell people, hey, this is it. I'm sorry. I'm good at this. I'm horrible at that. And you can tell me, well, if you just practice, you'll get better. Well, about some things I will, but not about everything. You know, if you can't draw, odds are you will never draw no matter how hard you try. If you're tone deaf, you cannot learn to be a good singer. I'm sorry. It's not possible. It will not happen. That's just the way it is. But we live in a culture that doesn't want to accept reality. But the reality that Paul gives us in 2 Corinthians 12, 8 through 10 is liberating. Because first of all, I accept the truth that everyone knows, but no one wants to admit so they don't get the big self-esteem lecture. Second, it doesn't damage their little, you know, fragile ego. Secondly, once I accept this and admit this, I can rejoice in it. Why? Not because I'm putting myself down, not because I hate myself, not because of anything about myself at all. I wish more Christians would understand this in our self-esteem Christian culture that we live in. It's not about me. It's not about any esteem. It's about God. When I boast in my weaknesses, when I am honest about it, then I can turn to God and God's power can flow through me, and then it's God, not me. You see, when I'm weak, I'm strong because I'm letting go of myself, both my weaknesses and my strengths, and I am embracing God and I am letting God work through me, and that's how you can be weak and strong simultaneously. I am weak because I am human, but God's strength can flow through me. So it's not about me at all. It's all about God, and it's about Jesus Christ, and it's about his grace, which is sufficient for all things, no matter how horrible they may be. And with that, I think it's time to close this podcast. I hope you got something out of all this. I'm finding this study on stewardship so profoundly deep because it covers everything in the Christian life, just about. We'll get into more stuff next week, so be ready for that. The big surprise from that came to me a couple of weeks ago, we are going to teach on that. I'm going to talk about that next week, so be sure and be here. Tell your friends about the podcast. Please encourage them to listen and tune in. We need people who understand this and can let go of this shallow self-esteem Christianity and embrace the profoundly honest, the profoundly real, the profoundly powerful experience of being weak before God and admitting all of that, being weak before man, people, human beings, the world, so that God can be strong through me, through you, through all of us. If you'd like to get a hold of me, please send me an email, Louie, L-O-U-I-E, at discipleup.org, or drop by the Facebook page, facebook.com/discipleup. I would love to hear from you. So until next time, take care, everybody. Thank you so much for listening, if you still are. God bless each and every one of you, and remember that every time is a good time to be a good steward and disciple up. So long.
Disciple Up, the Empowering Disciples podcast, is written, produced, directed, in as much as there's any direction to this thing at all, edited every once in a while, and paid for by Louie. It's his personal ministry, and is not connected to Christ Church on the River. CCR does not sponsor, pay for, or necessarily approve the content found therein. The theme music for Disciple Up is Hot Wheels by Varensky. Yes, Louie actually paid for the rights to this very cool piece of music, so don't worry, and please call off the lawyers, as he's busy enough without having to deal with all that. All opinions expressed during Disciple Up are Louie's, and Louie's alone. They do not necessarily represent those of our sponsor, the Lord Jesus Christ. However, where the opinions, thoughts, impressions, and feelings shared are in line with God's Word, and faithfully represent what our Lord says in his holy word, the Bible, then they are representative of our Lord Jesus Christ. If you're wondering how the heck you're supposed to know this, remember, God tells you to test all things. Hold on to the truth. It's up to you to do the due diligence that God commands, so do it. Don't whine about it, and don't complain about how hard it is. Don't blame me for it. Disciple Up, and do what you know you're supposed to do. If you'd like to know more about Louie or Disciple Up, please go to discipleup.org and check out everything you find there. Or not, it's completely up to you. Disciple Up, the Empowering Disciples podcast, will, God willing, publish an episode every week covering different areas of concern to disciples of Jesus. If that's important to you, then please subscribe on iTunes, Google, Stitcher, or another one of the many podcast aggregators available to you. If it's not, then don't. If you'd like to get in touch, please email Louie at Louie@discipleup.org. God bless you.